Jesus reigns. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God reigns. Hallelujah. He reigns. He reigns. Hallelujah. He reigns. He
into the end, there's no place for you. You are God alone.
You are God alone.
You've got times and seasons in your hands. You called for light out of darkness. You don't need a man to be the God you are. But you have chosen to call us your own. Oh, you are God. Oh,
you are God. From beginning to the end, there's no place for argument.
You are God alone.
You are God all by yourself.
Worship. Can I remind you? Can we be quiet for a moment? Can I remind you that you are still in the presence of God? When you say you are in the presence of God, you're talking that, or you're saying that the God Almighty is there. And when God is here, He makes this place to become a holy ground. And when God is here, He makes this place to be dreaded by the enemies. And when God is here with His embodiment, everything is possible to happen. Because the Bible says, with God, all things are possible. I want you to, just in a moment of silence, you know, one thing is to come to church and have activities, and then the time comes, we go. But there is something more than that. If only you will get understanding. Rabasata, thank you, Father. When the year began, it looks like it's going to take a long time for the year to come to an end. And now we are in the sixth month, and even the sixth month, we've gone half of it. I just want you to be silent and reason and think. Reason with the Lord's presence about your life. About the year. And about the state of your heart. You know, it can be so easy that we are carried away by activities and routine. Because the morning comes, we have already planned. And it becomes a routine that we know just when to pray and how to pray. And we counted, I've done my morning prayer because when I wake up, I just prayed. A time comes, it becomes a routine of satisfaction for yourself. And God is no more there. You're just satisfying yourself of what you are used to. What you have built yourself like to. But there is nothing significant or something in you that says you are drawing closer to God and you're still going to heaven. Create in me a clean heart, oh Lord, because there is no time. And renew right spirit. Create in me a clean heart, oh Lord. How can I come to his presence? Hey, thank you, Lord. Cast me not away from your presence, O Lord. Then we are done. There's no need. What people are lacking today. By quest or pursuit, salvation means nothing. I don't have this, but I have Jesus means nothing anymore.
Creating me a new.
Give me Jesus and take the whole world means nothing anymore. I have Jesus, I have all.
Right spirit within me.
There must be right spirit in us.
Creating me a clean heart, oh Lord.
Every right spirit within me. Cast me not
away from your presence, O Lord.
When two or three, I got that.
Take not the Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and renew thy spirit within me.
Be glorified in my life. Be glorified, be thou glorified. Be glorified.
Be
yes, Father.
Be glorified.
Yes, Lord. Hey, no man can make you God. Do we still believe that there is God?
Be glorified.
Do our attitude, do our intention, do our character still know that there is God? Not by the mouth of
Jesus.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Father. When time cometh, oh God. Lord.
Glory, my.
and give God thanks for your life. Go ahead and give God thanks for your life. Go ahead and give God thanks to your life. Your attitude does it show that it's still God? Go ahead and thank the merciful one. The one that has kept me and you. The one that is so patient towards us. The one that has even looked at us. And everyone has gone to his own tent. Let us just give him thanks. The merciful God. The most merciful and compassionate God. Thank you, Lord.
Be glorified in the heavens.
In Jesus' name we are worshiping.
Amen.
Can we pray for the children? They sang that joy should stay in their life. This is a family Sunday, but we want our children that are singing that the joy and peace shall stay in their life. But I want to tell you, parents, you can contribute to in a way that these children are not having peace in their life. You can contribute in a way that these children are not having joy in their life. They came here in the presence of God. Maybe you take it for granted as usual. And are singing a confession that peace will be staying in their lives. That joy, I don't know how you get prophetic about all these things. But I want us to cry to God concerning our children. That there be peace, there be joy. That all the parents, we're going to still pray for fathers. That whatever that is happening in our family, let it end in peace and joy. That our children, we have peace. Our children, we have joy. To the glory of the name of the Lord. In their school, they will have peace and joy. Because there is the overflowing of peace from home and from the church. Go ahead and begin to pray for our children. That the battle of the families, the distractions, that these children will grow in the house of the Lord. That these children will be protected by the Lord. The society is not friendly. The society is not friendly. Father, fight every battle in our family that we hold our peace. Oh God in heaven. In Jesus' name we are praying. We are going to pray for all the fathers in the house. Happy Father's Day. Brethren, as the Bible has made us to understand that the fathers are the head of the family. It doesn't matter whatever way any man sees to that. God that created us has made it that the father, by reason of orderliness structure, that the fathers are the head of the families. And it is very, very, you know, kind of that. When a father does not know the Lord, even if the woman knows the Lord, there is going to be a struggle in that family because the security head is not following the right direction. I don't want to go into teaching about fatherhood, but what we want to do is to pray for all fathers, that God will restore them. That as many that are struggling to provide for their families, which they ought to do, that God will make a way for them. Any father that is not yet saved, whether here or not here today, as a point of contact, we're going to call God to please save our fathers. That they will come to church with their wives. In the name of Jesus, let us begin to pray for father. Any yoke upon any father be broken now. In the mighty name of Jesus, whatever suffering, struggling, Oh, they struggle and struggle and struggle. Let us pray for our father, that God will make a way for our fathers. Oh, let us begin to pray for them. Let us begin to pray for them, that God will visit our fathers, that God will settle our fathers, that our fathers shall not be put to shame. None of us shall be put to shame. That God will fight our battle. The yoke upon any father, the yoke upon any father, let it be broken now, be destroyed in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, above all things, we ask for salvation. Salvation upon our souls. Salvation, Lord. Let salvation be mentioned in our families. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we are praying. And because the wind is blowing, the wind of God is blowing, I pray that the wind of God will not blow against us. In the name of Jesus. So you're going to cry to the Lord. I don't know what you want this wind. If the dry bones, even when they asked the prophet to prophesy, he said that God, you know. Because they asked, do you think? Which means that particular situation concerning the dry bone. Remember, these people were a great army before. And the Bible says now they become very, very, not one dry. If you read the Bible, say they were very, very dry. Which means the bones were scattered and there is no flesh. The dryness is in such a way that there is no hope. There is nothing any man can do again. And that is why even the prophet begin to think, this thing has gone beyond any kind of possibility. When God said, can these dry bones rise? He said, God, it's only you that know, because to my own understanding, I don't think it's going to be possible. And God said, prophesy. He couldn't even, until the second time he was asked, which is a witness. We're going to pray now. Brethren, no matter whatsoever, I want you to begin to, do you still believe there is God? Do you really still believe there is God? You want to pray now and ask the wind of God. Any area you want that wind to blow into your life and your family, the Bible says, ask and it shall be given unto you. Go ahead and cry to God and ask the Almighty. Let this wind that is blowing blow into your life, in whichever area, into your family. But let your wind bring me more closer to you, Lord. I want to be where you are. That your wind will make me to hear at all times when thou speaking, and restore me. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Our Father in heaven, we want to thank you for your God that answered prayers. You don't need any man to be the God whom you are. You love us so much that all what you're asking us to do is to our own benefit. Not because we do it to make you God. You're already God by yourself. From everlasting to everlasting. Please, Father, take all the glory. Speak to us now, that we will not become a kind type of people that come to go, or because we want to fulfill an obligation that we have been in the church. Let no man, oh God, go home the same way, or any woman the same way we have come, Father, today. Do something beyond our expectation and give each and every one of us a word and take all the glory. In Jesus' mighty name we are praying. and amen. Give God a big clap offering. You're all welcome in Jesus' name. Please let me make this announcement again. The Province Day prayer is going on because of our Province Day on Saturday. And all the parishes in Sweden and Norway that are part of our Province 1 are leading the prayers. Even today, one parish in Norway, I think Day Spring, is going to lead the prayer by 7. It's just 30 minutes prayer. So please, the link will be sent. Just join and pray. And also tomorrow, Redemption Parish, that's Homlia, will be leading tomorrow from 7 to 7:30. And then on Tuesday, the House of Prayer Parish will be leading on Tuesday, which that is why we ask us that we shouldn't, you know, our prayer is by 7 and the Province Day prayer is by 7. So we start from 7. It's shorter than even our 1 hour prayer. So it's from 7 to 7:30. So please, prayer is prayer. Be part of it today if you have the time tomorrow until Friday. That is how it's going to be. So let us quickly turn to our Bible. We're still going to be looking, like I said, sometimes people will ask me, you start a teaching and then all of a sudden you don't complete it. That was before. We're going to be looking at this, praise the Lord. We're going to be looking at or continuing in our teaching that says In One Accord, part 2. Your destiny is going to run into parts. Part 2, In One Accord. Our text still remains Psalm 133 from verse 1 to 3. I read, he said, behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity, to dwell together in one accord. That's another word for it. And then he said, it is like when we dwell together in one accord, in unity, he said, it will be like the precious ointment upon the head that ran down upon the bed, even Aaron's bed, that went down to the skirts of his garment, as the dew of Hermon, and as the dew that descended upon the mountains of Zion. For there, when they dwell in unity, when anointing flows, that's what he's talking about, you know, all ye precious ointment upon the head, that ran from the head, which is signifying anointing. And he said, when they dwell in unity, this is going to be very pleasant. And then there will be a great anointing. And he said, now the Lord will command his blessings. So I want us to begin to reason when we're asking some question. He said, when this unity dwelling happens, in that place, the Lord commanded his blessing, even life forevermore. Praise the Lord. Even life forevermore. Let me recap a little bit of our part one, because we're going to read a lot of Bible. I'm not going to go into so many things about the part one. I told us that when the Bible says that it is so pleasant for people to dwell in unity, or when two or three are gathered, it does not necessarily mean this gathering that we are here in terms of just numbers. That what the Bible is saying in the real sense of it is that dwelling in unity is something of the heart. It's something of the heart. We can gather here, do all sorts of the things we are doing, try all sorts of dancing we want to try, but we are divided in our hearts. It shows that some set of people are in unity, which I'm going to explain, and some set of people are not in unity. What happens? He said, how pleasant when they dwell in unity. So if you're here, for example, and your heart is quite different from what it ought to be, you are not in unity. You are not dwelling in one accord. And brethren, You see, the excess of unifying things, or when we say one accord, is just talking about the same mind at the time you gather, at all time, the same spirit. It simply means the same mind, the same spirit, the same heart. You are like-mindedness. There is a kind of unifying of the heart. We are gathered here now as a people we can count our numbers. But the excess of dwelling in unity, which I'm going to explain, is now how many hearts are in oneness here? How many hearts are unified in one? How many hearts are thinking like-mindedly? That is what the Bible is talking about. That is what the Bible is saying. Like I said, I'm not going to dwell in part one so much. If you look at Jesus Christ, in the Bible, the issue of the heart was mentioned, or is mentioned, almost about 1,000 times. When I'm looking at it, I was so surprised that from Genesis, God was so intentional talking about the heart of the people. The heart of the people. To the extent that if you check the whole Bible, it's more than 1,000 times that heart was mentioned in the Bible. How serious it is. And that is why I tell us that, you know, God is not a man. We can do whatever we want to do. We can dance however we want to dance. But what God is looking at is the heart. Are you intentional or are you drawing attention? Are you drawing attention? Are you dancing to your own glory or to Jesus? You know, it doesn't matter how we are so good in activities if we don't have one like mind. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So, brethren, because of time, I have spoken about this in the first chapter, and also how even David, and what the Bible is talking about, even in the prayer and the time of gathering. Because if you look at us here now, brethren, let us speak the truth in Christ and light not. There are people that are sitting here, they are not happy with someone else, which means the heart is divided. The heart. And when you come to the presence of God, he said, in his presence there is fullness of joy. And now, you come here, even while you are dancing, you know, together dwelling is not about the dancing. It's not about laughing. I can laugh at you, which we're going to go to part two, and look at what the Bible says of the heart. I can laugh at you because I was forming to laugh, but from my heart, I am not laughing. And what God says is not your 32 teeth that was open. He searched the heart. That is it. So it's not about how you form this mind. It's not about how you open the mouth wide and laugh. What God is looking at, the intention and the connection of your heart with the laughter. And that is why God will look at you and say, no, you're a deceiver. And to you, the person say, you're my friend. Which one do you think? Brethren, you can't begin to play God. And that is why sometimes when we ask a lot of questions, you know, this time people are traveling, people are living their life and doing whatever they want. When we ask questions, we don't look into our lives. If I ask you the question now, before I go to look at the Bible, tell me, just say the truth, because God is here, not a man that is here. What is the state and condition of your heart? Say the truth to yourself so that you save yourself all this pretense and all the kind of practice of church going. Save yourself the truth, because God is the one that will bless. God is the one that will help. God is the final sayer. He's God. And that is why he's interested in the heart. One accord. Let's go to see what the Bible says about this heart. Some of the things the Bible says about the heart of a man. As we proceed, let us look at, you know, sometimes when brethren, you see, there is no point when God is saying a thing. Let's let God be God and every man a liar. What you need to do is not to pray. You just need to come to God as you are, desiring and determined for a change. Because your heart is who you are. Your heart is who you are. And that is what God is looking at. It's not about how you dress. Even your dressing comes from your heart. Everything you do comes from your heart. And that is why if you neglect your heart, if you neglect your heart, soon you will begin to have worldly thoughts in your heart. Go and check it. There's no two point about it. If you neglect your heart, you are what your heart is inside you. So everything about God is the heart, is about heart. It's the heart thing. It's the heart thing. And that is why, even when David was dancing, the wife misunderstood that. God, they said the Spirit of God came upon him, he began to dance. He couldn't, he has no formula of dancing. That people, he forgot about king, because who is he before the King of Kings? And the wife misunderstood, but from his heart, he was dancing that he can never be king without the king. And the heart of David was different, and the wife's heart was different. Let us look at Matthew. Matthew chapter 5, verse 8. We're going to see what the Bible says about the heart and how to walk worldly. I said it's going to be in part. The Bible says, the word of God says, blessed are the pure in heart. The only group that will see God is those that is pure in heart. Which means there are sins you have not committed, but when they begin to run in your thought at all times, there is tendency you're going to commit that sin. And that shows that if your thought is engraved with a particular evil, you're not pure in the heart. And he said, that is why there are sins of thoughts that will make someone not to see God. Blessed are the pure in heart, for only them will see God. Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9 to 10. Jeremiah 17, verse 9 to 10. The heart is deceitful above all things. When I look at this yesterday or day before yesterday, I haven't marked, pay attention about this above all things. All things. You know, when I look at it, I begin to say, God, help me. He said the heart is above everything you can think of. Above all things. Above all things. The heart is deceitful. And he said it's not only that this heart is deceitful. It is desperately wicked. You hate me and you're laughing at me. You're laughing with me and I'm not seeing your heart. And you're even planning to destroy me. He said, who can know it? Who can know it? And then he goes further to say, now, because of this, I, the Lord, search the heart and not your activities, which are very good. I, the Lord, searched your heart. When you come to the church, I search your heart. I am the one that will give you according to your artwork. You know, when I look at it, and he said, I, the Lord, searched the heart, try the reins, even to give every man according to his ways. You are your heart, according to the fruit of his heart's doing. You know one thing that is about this? It's not only that this heart is desperately wicked. You know, the wickedness of the heart is that the heart will deceive you that is having the heart. That is the wicked. Isn't that bad? The thing you're planning against. That heart, you're planning that God is saying, no, no, is deceiving you. And that is why you think you're doing the right thing. You think that because I gave all the sign, you think that this is the way it should be. You think that, and the heart is deceiving you and leading you to destruction. And it is your own heart, not somebody's heart. Think about what you're doing today. Think about why you don't like my face. It's your heart that is telling you shouldn't do that. And the voice is coming. And you decide that you think you're doing the right thing, but the heart is deceiving you because God is searching the heart. God is God. God is real. Heaven is real. And the heart is so desperately wicked. Everything you do today, you ponder in your heart. I don't want to talk to that sister again because, hey, the other time, the way she looks at me, the heart is telling you, you don't want, the way she looks at you is enough. You decide that in your heart. You don't want to come to church. You decide that in your heart. Is your heart leading you to write that it's wicked to you that owns it? To destroy you for time's sake. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23. Keep thy heart with all diligence. For out of it are the issues of life. It's telling you, above all things, guide your heart, for everything you do flows from it. Everything you do flows from your heart. Keep thy heart. You know, it's a treasure. That is why I say, where you neglect the thought and your heart, you're bound to become worldly. Because everything you do, even when you say, see, brethren, I wonder, sometimes our brother or some of us will come here. Time permits me, if not today, we will teach about this. It's still a part of this one accord. How can you have one spirit, as we said we have the Spirit of God? And it is very, very easy for you to give excuse why you are not in a Bible study. Very simple and easy. And your heart will tell you you did the right thing. And your heart. And you'll be so comfortable. Brethren, tell yourself the truth. Are you having one spirit? When the spirit says gather, and you're having the Spirit of God in you, you don't have the Spirit of God. Tell yourself the truth. Tell yourself the truth. Forget about all this. Who is saying the words? Who is righteous? It's not about your heart is wicked and will deceive you. Someone has to beg you. Someone thinks that pertains to life. Things that is part of the kingdom where you belong to. Things that God Almighty says you should do. And someone has to beg you to serve, to come to church or to serve God. Someone, when your heart is there and wicked unto you. Keep your heart with all diligence. For out of it flows life, the issues of life. Matthew chapter 15, verse 8. Matthew chapter 15, verse 8. Matthew chapter 15, verse 8. Thank you, Lord. These people, I don't know who are these people. These people drawing near unto me with their mouth. Oh, one thing that is sure is that no one can deceive God. Forget about pastor, this one, that one. Title ends here. Everything ends here. God knows. These people draw near unto me with their mouth and honorate me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. They come to sing. They come to pray. When they leave my presence, they go their own way. And their heart is not with me. They don't know me. They don't honor me in reality. They show attention. There's no intention about it. It's not from the heart. That just pulling crowd. These people, they draw near to me, say the Lord, with their mouth. And honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Mark chapter 7, 21, 23. For from within, out of the heart of man, proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murderers, theft. It's out of the heart, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye. You know, oh God help us. God help us. Evil eye. Somebody is looking at you. Because you look at the person, he's looking with a good eye. When you turn back, that's another kind of eye. You see, what I'm trying to say here, brethren, is that the Bible is talking about from the heart, these things are going to be coming out. Pride, foolishness, all these evil things come from within the heart. And that is what is defiling a man. When you're hearing the word of God, the essence of this hearing, I say faith cometh, is that you begin to be honest to yourself and allow the Holy Spirit to do a work in you. At any time you're hearing the word of God and you think that what you're doing is right, I know what I'm doing, you're not even thinking of a change. You know, you can never become a new person except you change your mind. You see, and if you think that because you are who you are, as you sing or claim, that is not what in the sight of God is. The essence of coming to church is to get blessing and to renew your mindset and to draw closer and to repent at all times. That's the essence. So that you can, when I say silent, you can check last year, I gossip a lot, or last 3 months, and this month, I have drawn near to God, I am no more gossiping. I talk too much on Facebook or whatever. This year, I mind my words, and I do these things for God. There must be. You cannot be coming to church 1 year, 2 years. It's not because the word of God is not coming out to you. It's because you have made up your heart and your mind how you will live your life and who you will be. Out of this, if you are withdrawing from the things of God, it's because you have made up in your heart that it doesn't worth it, or that I need to withdraw. Brethren, can you check into your life and see? Because, you know, if you're reading your Bible, the problem we have sometimes, some of us, is that we make this life a Sunday thing. And every other day from Monday till Friday or Saturday becomes our own life. You know, we have our own life from Monday till Friday. And then we give God 2 hours on Sunday and then we feel fulfilled. And you love the things that matters, the things that can guide, the things that can, the God that can protect you, the God that can say no. You love the things behind and you're following the things that does not matter. And you feel fulfilled because your heart said so. Brethren, it ought not to be. It ought not to be. Romans chapter 10, verse 10. Romans 10, verse 10. For with the heart man believeth, like as I was saying, unto righteousness. First, you must with your heart believe before you begin to make the confession with your mouth. With your heart. So in the state of your heart, you are not, and you're just making mouth confession. You are wasting your time. You're wasting your time. We are dealing with the heart. To be in one accord. You are wasting your good time. For it is out of the heart man believeth unto righteousness. And with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Ezekiel chapter 11 verse 19. Ezekiel chapter 11 verse 19. He said, and I will give them one heart. And I will put a new spirit within you. And I will take the stony heart of their flesh. And I will give them an heart of flesh. And I will give them one heart. And take away the stony heart. You see how God is interested in our hearts. You see how God does not so much. It is very important. But all this dancing and jumping and whatever is good. You're praising God. But what is the intention and the state of your heart? That it doesn't matter whatever activity is acceptable just by men, and but God searched the heart. And that is where I will give them one heart. That is the unity we are talking about. Can I have the heart, the mind of Christ, and I am doing, and you having the same spirit of God, you're doing differently. What kind of spirit do we have? You have the word, the spirit of God. One heart, and you're doing a very different, and I'm doing, we have to check ourselves, who is having the right, and let us check, it's according to what the Bible says, what is written, what is written. Second Chronicles, I will round off from here, we'll continue. Second Chronicles chapter 16 verse 9. Second Chronicles. verse 16. I mean, 2 Chronicles chapter 16, verse 9. Chapter 16, verse 9. 2 Chronicles. Chapter 16, verse 9. He said, 2 Chronicles, not 1st. For the eyes of the Lord, where we are sitting here now, run to and fro throughout the whole earth. And he's going to show himself strong in the behalf of them whose heart is perfect towards him. Hearing that has done foolishly, therefore from henceforth that shall have wars. The heart eyes of the Lord runs to and fro, watching every second. And he will come to show himself strong to them, which heart is perfect towards thee. Let me close up with this analogy. We will continue another part. You know, while I was doing this, the Lord took me to our journey to Eurocon. Our journey to Eurocon. And I was like, you know, I begin to, you know, the Lord is just like an open discussion. He said, okay, we are traveling to Eurocon to Spain. Most of us took different flights. And when we took different flights, we're going to transit in different places. But our final destination is Spain. Our final destination is Spain. But we are taking different flights and different transit. And you know, when we get to our transit point, we have not arrived. Therefore, we didn't just pack up. What do we do? All of us in every transit point are so focused, so alert. No matter how tired, how weak we are listening because we have not come to the final destination and this is not our place. So what we do is that you're tired, you're pinching yourself. They're announcing you're listening because they can change gate. And all your focus is your final destination. And what all of us are looking at, who have arrived at final destination? I will call, I will say, Pastor, say, have you arrived? I'm still on the journey. I am still on transit, which means all our focus as oneness to spend is to arrive on a final destination. We're on a journey. We're on a journey. And sometimes people will arrive at different times. But there is a final destination. Have you arrived? If you have changed your life, if you have quitted the things God says you should do, if you have withdrawn, if your heart is not in one accord, have you arrived? I want you to rise up on your feet. I couldn't believe it. Even some of us spent 3 hours, but we are not tired because we want to get to the final destination. Some of us, we are so weak, but we want to get to the final destination. Belgium might be better, but I'm going to Spain. And therefore, Belgium, you cannot distract me. My final destination is Spain. I cannot park. I cannot sit here. I cannot begin to build tent here. My heart cannot accept here because my final destination is Spain. I want you to pray. I'll continue next time. Don't allow people to deceive you that it's no God. Or coming to church does not matter. But make up things for your life. Why do you quit so easily? Why is it so easy for you to withdraw? Why do your heart deceive you that what you're doing is right? That it doesn't matter whether you be part or you do this or that. No matter how difficult the life may be, no matter how you are waiting for a particular thing to happen in your life, is it a time to quit? Is it a time to play church? Father, thank you because you have spoken to us. Help us to reach our final destination and make us to be in one accord. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Shall we share the grace and fellowship? By the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. I, the Lord, search the heart. If your heart is right with God, you might make a mistake, but He knows the heart of your intention. Thank you, Lord. So shall it be in Jesus' name. Have a blessed week beyond your expectation and draw nearer to God. Let us help the media and others to pack things. God bless us.